So I'm going to introduce our speaker for today, Peter Hobson. Peter is a psychoanalyst licensed from the California Medical Board. He was trained at the British Psychoanalytic Society and is also on faculty of the San Francisco Center for Psychoanalysis. He's a psychiatrist with the UK equivalent of an MD degree in the US and a psychologist with a PhD from University of Cambridge. He is Emeritus Professor of Developmental Psychopathology, University College London, and a lifetime honorable consultant psychiatrist in psychotherapy at the Tavistock Clinic in London. He led a research unit at University College and worked as a psychotherapist in the UK National Health Service and the adult department of the Tavistock Clinic. So welcome, Peter.
So the first thing is to check the sound. If the sound is a problem, how's the man to wave to adjust it? So I take no responsibility for that bit, but I've got plenty of responsibility for the next hour and a half to contend with. Well, the second thing to say is to thank you. Thank you for allowing me to speak in this slot. Thank you for having me. Thank you for coming this morning. Thank you for laying on some English weather to make me feel even more at home. And I'm going to be talking about something which I won't disguise, I have a passion about, something I feel is terribly important, about interpersonal engagement and about a particular therapeutic orientation on working in the transference. And I put with individuals and couples, and I'll state right at the outset, I'm not a couples therapist, although I've seen one or two couples in my time, and mostly we'll be focusing on individuals, but I am very aware that many of you work with couples, and I've put in couples, and we'll say a little bit towards the end about working the transference with couples, just a little bit, not in any way from an expert point of view, partly in order to open that up for discussion, because I would very much like to hear you talking about your experience or your thoughts about working in the transference with couples as well as individuals. So let's see if I can work this. I'll try the other way. Down, there we go. So I imagine, I haven't actually timed myself, though I roughly know how long I'll take. I intend to take about an hour, so we've got half an hour for discussion. If it's somewhat less, more discussion, so much the better. And the presentation that I'm going to give has four parts. The first part I'm going to have to do a little bit of theory on the transference, on the internal world as seen by psychoanalysts, and on a particular process that is fundamentally important about building up an internal world and about understanding how transference works, that is the notion of identification, identifying with. Part two, which in a sense is the kind of core, the heart of my presentation, will be a particular clinical illustration which I'm going to actually read out from my from one of the, my books to try to illustrate in an accessible way an actual person, me, struggling to work in the transference at the very beginning of an assessment consultation. How to understand what seems to be going on, and in particular, how to put oneself in a position to think about one's own involvement, how one is being implicated in patterns of repeating relatedness and relationship with the individual in front of one. Now, I say individual, and I did think about using up my 11 seconds introducing myself, but that's kind of been done for me. The bit I will say, by way of explanation, you'll notice I speak in a slightly unusual way. I wasn't born in Sonoma County. But have been here for almost for over 3 years and are building up a psychoanalytic practice in the Bennett Valley. I have my consulting room and consulting room suite. Actually doing, somewhat to my surprise, psychoanalysis. Not actually 5 times a week, but most of my clients come 3 times a week, use a psychoanalytic couch, and I'm sitting at the top. And it rather has surprised me that people have found me out for that particular approach. I thought I'd be doing brief psychotherapy, which I know from the National Health Service, bless it, in the United Kingdom. Okay, so that's my 11 seconds. Back to our presentation. Clinical illustration is going to be the core. Then, rather more briefly, I'm going to tell you about a research study that colleagues and myself did. As you've heard, I ran a research unit at University College London. And then a little bit of a PS, which actually links with the research study about transference in couples therapy. Gone the wrong way. Here we go, down. I'll keep my thumb hovering. So here's Freud on transference, the notion of transference. And forgive me, I'm really not wanting to talk to those. Many of you will know what I'm about to say, but it's also helpful to gather it together, even if so. And once somebody came up to me and said, well, I might be a bit rusty. It was about 30 years ago that I was into the more psychoanalytic way. So forgive me if I'm telling you stuff that you're already very familiar with. So here's good old Freud. What are transferences? They are new additions, or facsimiles, kind of printouts, if you like, of the impulses and fantasies which are aroused and made conscious during the progress of the analysis. But they have this peculiarity, which is characteristic for their species, that they replace some earlier person by the person of the physician. And this is an amazing discovery. So he sits there with his clients, and he finds that something goes on within the framework, which is a rather strict framework. You begin at a particular time, end at a particular time, have set conditions for listening to a patient in a particular way. And what happens is that impulses and fantasies are aroused, and in some ways, the physician, the therapist, gets implicated because the patient finds in their therapist features, characteristics, tendencies that they seem to experience from other people in intimate relations outside the consulting room. In other words, the therapist gets woven in to some very important dynamics when it comes to intimate relations that this person has had in the past, continues to have in their present, and now, in a concentrated form, has in relation to the psychoanalyst. And that is very important because we are trying not just to understand, but to help people. And if it were not the case that the focus on the transference now, the relationship with me, if it were not the case that that was deeply relevant for the problems that the person presents with, then it wouldn't be justifiable to focus on it. But the idea in psychoanalysis is that's absolutely the most alive, the most relevant, the most accessible part of the patient's presentation that one can get hold of and work with. So it's a big deal. Now, I'm going to move. I'm still actually going to be thinking about the transference, but just shift emphasis slightly. The internal world. How do we think, how do analysts think, about the internal emotional world of a patient? Now, when teaching students at the Tavistock Clinic, for instance, and they ask me, well, look, where in Freud do we go? What's the best place to start? I recommend the first five pages or so of Mourning and Melancholia. And it's a gem of psychoanalytic thinking, I think. Mourning and Melancholia. And what Freud is doing in Mourning and Melancholia, first five pages, not the rest of it, which gets rather complicated and unnecessary, but really, really good. He's saying, look, let's think about psychotic depression. He was thinking about melancholia, essentially people who have delusions, sometimes hallucinations, are really feeling that they are the kind of scum. They deserve to be in the gutter. They don't deserve to live. They should be hanged, drawn, and quartered. Seriously psychotically depressed individuals. And he made the very non-obvious link with mourning, loss, and the pain of loss, and the process through which one has to go when losing someone who's dear to one. Now, I'm not going to go into that too much because it would take me away from the central theme of today. But here is Freud, and I just love the way he's wrestling, as he often does, with what's going on. In mourning, it is the world which has become poor and empty. In melancholia, it is the self, the ego, itself. The patient represents his ego to us as worthless, incapable of any achievement, morally despicable. He reproaches himself, vilifies himself, and expects to be cast out and punished. And listen to this. It would be equally fruitless from a scientific and a therapeutic point of view to contradict a patient who brings these accusations against himself. He must surely be right in some way and be describing something that is, as it seems to him, to be. We see how in him, one part of the self sets itself over against the other, judges it critically, and as it were, takes it as its object. So what Freud is saying is this. You are presented with a patient, and what you see is a single human being. But listen carefully. In this single human being, you are also witnessing a relationship. And it's not very nice. In the case of certain forms of melancholia, it is one part of the individual denigrating, attacking, despising another part of the individual who is denigrated, despised, and attacked. Now, our natural inclination is to sympathize with the person who's being attacked. Our natural inclination is to say, don't think that about yourself. You're a much better person than you're saying. Be kind to yourself, and so on. That's not wrong. We all need support, encouragement. But let's not forget the other side of the picture. The other side of the picture being that part of the person that is doing the attacking, doing the accusing, doing the denigrating. And why should we not forget about that side? Because the patient may need help with tackling that side of his or her personality just as much as needing support for the attacked, vulnerable side. So this is what Freud is saying in Mourning and Melancholia. And it's a very important claim. But how can this have happened? We now get a developmental perspective. And this is important for two reasons. One is we want to understand how a person comes to be like this. Not just melancholia, but actually how we build up our own internal worlds. So it's a general issue. But also, as psychoanalysts, and indeed as many of you are, you see yourselves, I see myself, as a developmentalist, namely, as concerned with promoting development, fostering development, removing barriers to development. It's very different from a surgeon who operates. Well, actually, in some ways, it's not so different. But anyway, it's very different from doing something to somebody. It's fostering development. So, what does Freud have to say about this? Freud exhorts us to listen carefully to what the patient is saying and how he's saying it, he or she. And he says, if one listens patiently, and I pause because probably the main point of what I'm going to be talking about today is about a certain kind of listening. That's about it, certain kind of listening. It's not entirely it, but you'll see. If one listens patiently to a melancholic's many and various self-accusations, one cannot in the end avoid the impression that often the most violent of them are hardly at all applicable to the patient himself, but that with the insignificant modifications they do fit someone else, someone whom the patient loves or has loved or should love. So we find the key to the clinical picture. We perceive that the self-reproaches are reproaches against a loved object, by which he means a person, a loved person, which have been shifted away from that person onto the patient's own self. So here's the story. I am in a relation to a person. Let's say Mr. B. He's important to me in particular ways we won't go into, but it's strong. I suffer a loss. That might be Mr. B dying, it might be Mr. B betraying me, it might be Mr. B insulting me or whatever. There's a loss. I hate Mr. B for doing this to me. Doing this to me. I now identify with Mr. B. So Mr. B, I'm taking up some parts of what Mr. B meant to me, and I'm taking them into my own personality. And having identified with Mr. B, who I would hate and want to attack, I now hate and attack Mr. B in myself, because I've identified with him. He's inside me, and I go on punishing cruelly Mr. B for having left, and he's now part. And in fact, in some ways, and this is important, I haven't lost him. He's now inside, and I've got him, and I'm going to go on punishing him. But of course, the tragedy is I'm also punishing myself, and a horrible thing is going on, sometimes relentlessly, that is not healthy and not happy. So, we come to identifying with others. This process, which is so fundamental in my view, an analyst view, for human development, I say in my view partly because actually a lot of my research was in autism, and I think that very central to understanding early childhood autism is their difficulties and their lack of this natural being pulled into identifying with other people. But I mustn't get onto that. Identifying. Identification in this sense is known to psychoanalysis as the earliest expression of an emotional tie with another person. He thinks there's something really important about the structure of social experience from very early in life. That actually this mode of linking with other people and of being able to identify with and take into oneself is something that goes on from very early in life. And there's been a whole analytic debate about how early. It plays a part in the early history of the Oedipus complex, and then here's an example which is not so early, which is just common sense. A boy will exhibit a special interest in his father. He would like to grow like him and be like him and take his place everywhere. As a matter of fact, my dad was a pipe-smoking psychotherapist. And I will leave it for you to guess whether I, as well as being a psychotherapist, also at one stage smoked a pipe, which I gave up 10 years ago. And here's a really important part of this story. Identifying with others is a psychological process whereby the subject assimilates an aspect, a property, or attribute of the other, and is transformed, wholly or partially, after the model the other provides. So think of yourselves, if this process is going on all the time, you can think of yourselves as therapists. And that one very important avenue of fostering development in your clients is in virtue of their identifying with you in relation to what they present and what they bring. Okay, so if it's the case, if you're convinced by whatever source of information or lecture, that identifying with is really important. It's really important for all people who engage in any kind of psychotherapy. That doesn't mean to say you have to focus on it, but it's going to be there. It's going to be happening. And finally, in this introductory bit, projective identification. Now, projective identification is kind of big news in psychoanalysis and has been for the last 2 decades. An idea started by Melanie Klein, a mechanism revealed in fantasies in which the subject inserts his self, in whole or in part, into the object, meaning person, in order to harm, possess, or control it. And actually, one ought to add on here, or communicate. And this is the idea that I might have experiences of myself that I can't manage, and in order to manage them, I project into the other, I mean, I know many of you know this, but allow me to go through it, into the other, so that the other carries and maybe expresses something which belongs with me, but I've actually don't have much about me, angry. And the person projected into finds herself stirred up and getting angry in ways that don't seem quite her, but they are her, it is your anger, in the presence of this very calm person. Okay, projective identification. I don't have to own my own anger, I locate it outside. That's just one simple example. That's obviously a terribly important. But that may not just be to harm, possess, or control. It may be my way of communicating. I need you to know that I can't deal with my anger because I'm getting you to deal with it. Okay, so it's a very important process. I see people nodding, which pleases me no end. Okay, so that's, I think, the end of... Okay, so here we go. Now, this is actually a patient I saw many years ago at the Maudsley Hospital, South London. It was one of the first assessment consultations I videotaped, so I actually had a transcript and actually could see something, which I will mention in terms of what happened. And I'm going to read it to you, and it's pretty well verbatim. I've disguised some personal information. I had written permission to present once the case was person was disguised. And I am not so much trying to illustrate, as I mentioned earlier, how I would try to frame interpretations, because actually this is the very beginning, very first meeting between me and this patient. But what I am trying to illustrate is a way of engaging and thinking. And something also, I hope, about why that might be important. And this was a middle-aged lady who came with chronic depression, not psychotic depression, not melancholia, but dysthymia, many years treated in various ways without success. And so she came to me in the consulting room. I did a consultation of 90 minutes. And I got background of referral letter and questionnaire. And I won't explain why I do what I do. I'm just going to, well, except insofar as holding your hand as we go through the first probably 15 minutes. I'm going to edit out a bit, but we're talking about the first 15 minutes of a first meeting with this lady. But she has been prepared by a questionnaire asking about personal things, and that's relevant. The patient, Ms. J, arrived on time for this first assessment interview. When I offered to shake her hand, which was also captured on videotape, because at this time, patients came directly to my room, which didn't happen, but so we have this camera on, patient comes in, and I offered her my hand, because I say, my name is Dr. Hobson. Something odd took place. Somehow, I could not tell how, I felt thrown off balance. It was as if I'd been clumsy and had made an awkward gesture. This was not a pleasant experience, but I more or less recovered and then sat down. So, as you all know, we are no longer just looking at the transference, we're also looking at the counter-transference, in the sense not originally that Freud meant, namely, you have to be careful of your own transference to the patient, but in terms of my feelings in relation to the patient's transference. And this illustrates how, if you're sensitive to this, you don't understand what it means, but you're registering, you're listening to something that gets communicated and picked up by your own human system. Okay, so my own human system says, something happened, and I'm not feeling good about this, and I recover. Okay, so that's the beginning of the interview. Actually, I think that the kernel of this patient's problems, as you'll see, was contained in that moment. But you can't know till later. And anyway, you might not agree, but I say no, but that's what I think. I began the session in my customary way by introducing myself, and I tend to be rather formal. My name is Dr. Hobson. I know that's not the California way, but... And I still do it. I think people forgive me. Actually, my clients here look a little bit stunned when I begin to wear. But they forgive me because I come from a strange culture. So, by introducing myself, saying how long we had, so I make it clear how long we've got, and then falling silent. With barely a pause to register what was happening, or what my state of attentiveness might be, Ms. J began recounting in a monotone how she didn't know why she got depressed. There didn't seem to be any reason for it. And I quote, "And if I'm feeling okay, when I do anything, I'm the type of person that always likes to have everything perfect. When I feel okay and I do what I have to do in the office, no matter what it is, well, when I try to tackle anything, if I do, I just feel that it is not the way I want it to be. Do you know what I mean? No? Okay, so let it work on you. And also ask yourself, what would you do in this moment, in this session? Now, this excerpt represents a distillation of a drawn-out soliloquy. Ms. J was speaking almost to herself, with hardly a look towards myself. As she spoke, I found my heart sinking. At the end of this initial statement about herself, Ms. J suddenly looked up at me, then away again when she says, you know what I mean, no? Although in her words she was asking if I knew what she meant, there was little to suggest she was interested in what I might have to say. I felt that perhaps I should say something to show that I was listening and to summarize where I had thought we had come thus far. Struggling for words, I began. But before I got any further, Ms. J interrupted. I've got this filing to do. Well, when I feel okay, I will do it. And although I'm never really satisfied with it, I mean, it's the best I can do. And say my aunt came to see me. I would say to her, I feel everything is a mess. And she would say to me, I'm too fussy. Well, I am. I know myself that when I do something, I do it better than most people. I'm more fussy than most people. But I never feel satisfied. And when I get depressed, I won't even attempt to do it because I will never really get it in order. That's just the way I feel about everything, really. At this point, there was a pause. By now, I felt at a loss. I wanted to say something to help, but I didn't know what that something might be. Ms. J herself seemed hopeless about the possibility of receiving help, and I wondered if she felt there was little point in trying to communicate with me. I said, and even trying to describe it to me, you get quite worried whether you'll be able to get it across. Miss J gave a sighing and distinctly unenthusiastic, yeah. In response and with some desperation, I tried to resuscitate my sentence by adding, and give enough reasons, and give a description that is good enough. Projective identification. Ms. J's response was to ignore what I had said, and to continue as if I'd not spoken. I suppose, in a way, I hate myself for being like this, but I can't control it. I don't know what else to say, really. It's just that, you know, no matter what I do, I'm never satisfied. There was a long pause. There was little to suggest that Ms. J was expecting me to say anything. She appeared to have had her say and was neither anxious nor interested in what might happen next. I tried to gather my thoughts. My attempt to offer an understanding remark had seemed a clumsy and useless thing to have done. Here we were, gloomily stuck, and with scant prospect of escape from the stuckness. It occurred to me afterwards how, had I been a primary care doctor or a busy general psychiatrist, the pull to action would have been irresistible. I would have begun by asking systematic questions about the phenomenology of Ms. J's mental state. Could she say a bit more about how she felt? Were things better or worse in the mornings or evenings? How was her sleep? Could she find interest in some things? And then I would have reached for the prescription pad. It would have been a relief to give Ms. J something that might, just might, improve her condition. Perhaps more important, if I prescribed medication, it would have allowed me to show her the door. I would not have had to deal with her repressive difficulties until a follow-up appointment 3 weeks later. Under these circumstances, then, aside from any psychiatric justification that might apply, prescribing medication would have fulfilled a number of emotional needs. First, I would have offered something, and Ms. J would have received something. After all, Ms. J came in need, and I never forgot that in all that I say. I was not feeling mocking towards her. I don't want that to come across. I took her seriously. And I felt sorry for her. She came in need, and she was expecting help. Second, I would have avoided the immediate prospect of feeling a failure and inadequate in what I could do. Third, I would have deflected awareness away from my own hostility. See, already I was apologizing to her, saying, you know, I wasn't just hostile, I was also concerned for her, but I knew somewhere in me her hostility was also getting stirred. By cutting her off and sending her home with something to, quote, make her better. Instead, I knew that my job as a psychotherapist was to do my best to survive the next hour and a half sitting with Ms. J as I tried to fathom what was happening and what this might signify. Perhaps most important, I had to hold back from action, like the prescribing, or like trying too hard to do things. Insofar as action meant living out a role into which Ms. J had inducted me. So we're now after about, 7 minutes, 8 minutes into the interview. My current inaction, then, was not going silent on Ms. J. I needed to avoid unhelpful action that might interfere with understanding. I needed to think. Then something struck me. When I had referred to Ms. J's anxiety about communication with me, what I had said did not ring true for Ms. J at the moment I said it. But it did ring true for what I was feeling. I was worried whether I would be able to get anything useful across, and I felt I would be unable to give enough reasons or give a description that was good enough. Not only did I feel this, I also expressed what I felt in both the delivery and content of my interpretation. By reflecting on what my own behavior and stance revealed to myself, I came to understand something important about Ms. J. What I had grasped at this point was that someone in this relationship was both anxious and intimidated by the pressure to come up with something worthwhile. After one or two more stuttering exchanges in which Ms. J said she did not know what else to say, I remarked, "What you convey is that there's something in you that requires nothing less than perfection." The point of this remark was to take up an issue that Ms. J had emphasized. This had seemed important for Ms. J's self-criticism, remember mourning and melancholia, but also something that was relevant to what was happening in relation to myself at that very moment. It may be worth commenting on some other features of this intervention. What I said took the form of a statement, not a question. I was trying to capture what was happening at the moment I spoke. I had pretty good evidence for what I said in Ms. J's repeated assertions about her not being satisfied. This tallied with my countertransference and specifically my own trepidation in saying anything. I was intimidated. In addition, of course, my statement conveyed that I was listening to and trying to understand what Ms. J was communicating. I was setting communication center stage. I had another aim. When someone presents with self-criticism, it is not difficult to sympathize. We tend to identify with the person as criticized. We might want to encourage the person to be more positive about him or herself and to marginalize negative cognitions. As Freud made clear, however, we need to contend as well with the person as critic. In the case of Ms. J, I needed to begin to address how, in a part of herself, she was actively critical and unsatisfied. So I made my intervention. So that was what you convey as something in you that requires nothing less than perfection. How did Ms. J respond? With a sigh. Ms. J resumed her monotone thus. I don't know, really. Since I was a child, I used to. Even the likes of my getting things ready for school and that. Although my grandmother did them for me, I preferred to do it myself because I felt that nobody could do it the way I did it. And I think, I don't know whether it started from when I was, it used to be just, when I was at school, I remember that I used to just like everything to be perfect, and no one could do it the way I did it. I prefer to do it myself. I think it's just escalated from there. I said, so there's something additional. It's not just that you can't do things well enough, but even before that at school, there was a feeling that nobody else could do things well enough, that only you could approach perfection with your getting ready for school and other things. Here I was simply trying to recapitulate what Ms. J had been saying. Well, not so simply. I was expanding and at the same time clarifying the picture. The expansion was that from childhood on, Ms. J's impatience and severity was directed at anyone who tried to help. The clarification was that she and only she was allowed to do anything, as I was discovering firsthand. Ms. J's reaction to my statement was to sigh again. She conveyed that what I'd said was really not worth my breath. Yet at the same time, when she resumed her account, that is, when she was doing something rather than I was doing it, she seemed to express very similar ideas. Yeah, it was just, wasn't really at school, it was just, I was just giving you an example of it. When I was getting something ready, or if I was going somewhere, even when I was small, I elected to do it myself because I thought no one could do it in the way I did it. So this is what I call a self-representing event in psychoanalysis. She is describing what she is at the very moment of describing it, doing. By now, I realized that I had to be very careful not to take the lead in anything, not just enacting giving medication, but even taking the lead, because we see what happens. Any insights that I might have would be dismissed rather than thought about. Although there was pressure on me to provide something worthwhile, it was hazardous even to offer ideas. The problem was not so much that I would have to suffer the consequences, that's something for which I am paid. Rather, I would be living out my role in Ms. J's script. This would not help her to think nor move us forward. Therefore, when Ms. J returned to the idea that all this might have started when she was small, you can imagine, you know, psychotherapists might be tempted to pursue this, to get some relief from what's going on. I steadfastly avoided following her lead. Okay, so she kind of asked me, do you think this might have gone on from when I was small? I said, what would you have said? I said, I wonder if you've asked yourself. Ms. J mumbled something. I said, I started by saying, you ask me, that was right. The first thing I said was, you ask me, because I thought she knew something, right? But she was projecting the responsibility for thinking about what she already half knew to me. And I just said, you ask me. Then she mumbled. Then I said, I wonder if you've asked yourself. So I'm still encouraging a process. She said, well, I think it did. I think it began trying to secure what seemed to be an important shift towards genuine reflection in Ms. J. I pressed the issue home. I said, before she's spoken, I said, I wonder if you yourself really believe. After hesitation, Ms. J said, in a convincing and moving way, oh, when I was small, my grandmother used, no matter what I did, it was never right. She used to always, well, that's just it in a nutshell. No matter what I did, it was never right, or never good enough, or I don't know. Well, it's just that. No matter what I did, it was never right. I couldn't do anything right. I suppose it was because I was the oldest. She used to take things out on me. Maybe she didn't even mean. She was just dissatisfied with her own life. So think identification, she as a young person identifying with the grandmother as experienced, we don't know what the grandmother's actually like, take it into herself, established within herself, and the pattern repeats. And then in the transference, this pattern going on in her mind all the time gets lived out, and it can get lived out both sides, because I was very aware that yes, at this beginning, so we've had 15 minutes after this, yes, at the beginning, I felt the one intimidated, pushed away, having nothing to offer. But I knew, pretty certainly, that if I got at all critical, it could switch. And that it would be me being the one saying, can't you give me a history better than that? What do you think you're doing here? Why ask me? And she would be the one then persecuted by my living out the persecuting role. Now, let's look at the time. Okay. I don't know what happened in her child, but I thought this sounded very authentic, I have to say, about her story. Let me return to that initial handshake. William Blake wrote of seeing a world in a grain of sand. If the first few minutes of a consultation are a grain of sand, then the first 10 seconds are a near microscopic particle. Yet contained within those first seconds of meeting was a core truth about Ms. J. I went back to the first half minute of the videotape of the session. What I found there was a behavioral expression of what I had registered as countertransference in my subjective experience. When Ms. J came into the room, I had extended my hand as I introduced myself. Ms. J responded by reaching forward with her hand. Then in the instant before our hands met, she withdrew hers, just a fraction. It was enough to generate in me a tiny but seismic shock. With remarkable specificity, my feelings at that moment were to map on to the feelings that Ms. J was to describe and have the two of us live out in the events that were to follow. But it was, if you want, you can come and shake my hand. So you're confident that I'm going to shake your hand, right? Uh-huh. All right? So you're suddenly not there.
And it makes me come.
And you, your impulse, firstly, you're disorientated. Then, as you say, you and are we meeting? And when we finally met up, you thought, what's gone on? But you don't know, it's a very important principle that the principle of registering what happens, knowing that you don't know what it means. It's only going to be the fullness of time, if you're lucky, that the truth will emerge, if it is the truth. I think that. Okay, so that's that. Now we have the final parts. We're doing not too badly with time, so let me, trouble is I always forget which of these I'm meant to press. Is it the top one or the bottom one? Bottom one. Here we go.